भोजन के बाद का सत्र प्रारंभ होने जा रहा है। आप सभी प्रतिभागियों से निवेदन है कि वे यथाशीघ्र सभा भवन में आने का कष्ट करें। इस सत्र की अध्यक्षता निभा रहे हैं प्रोफेसर शिशिर रॉय, और इस सत्र में तीन निबंध पढ़े जाएंगे, तीन विद्वानों के निबंध। प्रोफेसर मंगला चिंचोरे जी, आपसे निवेदन है कि आप यथाशीघ्र आने का कष्ट करें। मैं प्रोफेसर शिशिर रॉय जी से निवेदन करता हूं कि वे इस सत्र की अध्यक्षता स्वीकार करते हुए अध्यक्ष पद ग्रहण करें। इसमें तीन विद्वानों के लेख पढ़े जाएंगे, त्रिस्वभावा योगाचार विज्ञानवादा, प्रोफेसर मंगला चिंचोरे, लुकिंग डीप इनटू एग्जिस्टेंस द योगाचारा डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ द थ्री ट्रू, प्रोफेसर कुंतला भट्टाचार्य। आपसे निवेदन है कि आप आए मंच पर आसन ग्रहण करें। और तीसरा निबंध है प्रतीत समुत्पात एक विवेचन, प्रोफेसर हरिप्रसाद अधिकारी जी, आप भी आए और स्थान ग्रहण करें। आप शुरुआत कर सकते हैं सर, यू कैन स्टार्ट, है ना। लेट दी वी कैन चेंज द शिफ्ट हर to the second or third. Yeah.
good afternoon, everybody. Maybe you are feeling dizzy after great lunch. And as the first speaker is not around, so let us start in the reverse way. So the first speaker here, Professor Hariprasad Adhikari, he's from Sanskrit University in Varanasi. Yeah, the reverse order. So let me request Professor Adhikari.
Fuganga taranga ramaniya jata kalapam gauri nirantara vibhushitavam bhagam narayana priyamananga madapaharam varanasi purapatim bhaja vishwanatham anirodham anutpadam anuchedam saswatam anekartham ananartham anagamam anirgamam यः प्रतीत्य समुत्पादं प्रपञ्चोपशमं शिवं देशयामास सम्बुद्धस्तं वन्दे वदतां वरं यस्य दर्शनतेजांसि परवादिमतेन्धनं दहन्त्यद्यापि लोकस्य मानसानि तमांसि च। समादरणीय अध्यक्ष महोदय एवं अन्य वक्तृगण एवं हमारे सामने उपस्थित बौद्ध शास्त्र के अधिकारी विद्वद्गण, बड़े सौभाग्य का विषय है। प्रातःकाल से ही हम लोग जो है बौद्ध वाङ्मय से जुड़े विषयों की चर्चा में हम लोग समय यापित कर रहे हैं, इसमें आनंद ले रहे हैं। प्रातःकाल से ही अनेक विषयों का विवेचन यहाँ पर हो चुका है, की नोट एड्रेस से लेकर के अध्यक्षीय वक्तव्य और आगे के सेशन में भी बहुत अच्छी अच्छी बातें हो चुकी हैं। और यहाँ फिर और मुझे भी कुछ बातें रखनी है, लेकिन कुछ समस्याएं हमको, एक तो कुछ लाइट की कर रही है, लेकिन तो भी कुछ न कुछ बातें यहाँ प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद विषय चुना गया था। और यद्यपि मेरा जो पठन पाठन का मूल विषय है वो वेदांत और अन्य दर्शन रहे हैं, तथापि बौद्ध दर्शन भी उसमें एक अंग के रूप में मेरा विषय रहा, पढ़ते समय भी पढ़ाते समय भी। तो अनुसंधान के समय में भी हमने थोड़ा नागार्जुन के माध्यमिक कारिका को रखा था, शून्यवाद और अद्वैत वेदांत का तुलनात्मक अध्ययन ऐसा किया है हमने। तो उसी में कुछ करते करते ये जो प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद आदि विषयों से कुछ परिचय हुआ और कुछ बोलने का अवसर मिलता है। इसमें अधिकारिता अपनी मैं नहीं मानता हूँ, लेकिन कुछ ये एक प्रकार से श्रद्धा युक्त होकर के मैं बौद्ध दर्शन का अध्ययन करता हूँ। और जो बौद्ध दर्शन के पंडित जहाँ नहीं हैं, जहाँ शुद्ध सनातनी विद्वानों के बीच में जब बोलना पड़ता है तो मैं कई प्रश्नों का समाधान भी वहाँ कर देता हूँ। एक बात यहाँ बताना जरूरी है, प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद के विषय में हमने BHU में लेक्चर दिया है काशी के पंडितों के बीच में, और वहाँ तो काफ़ी विद्वान नाराज हो जाते हैं ऐसा सुन करके, क्योंकि बौद्ध दर्शन का प्रतिपादन करने का मतलब है अनात्मवाद की बात वहाँ आ जाएगी तो आत्मवाद का निराश होगा, आत्मा का खंडन होगा, तो एक जो वैदिक धारा के लोगों को स्वतः कष्ट हो जाएगा वहाँ पर अपना इसको विपरीत मान करके बातें होंगी, तो बहुत तर्क वितर्क है इसमें, बहुत लंबा है आप जान ही रहे हैं, अनंत है, तो भी मैं अपने शास्त्रीय हिसाब से जवाब दे देता हूँ, लेकिन आप लोगों का यहाँ मैं जवाब इसलिए नहीं दे पाऊँगा कि आप उसके अधिकारी खुद विद्वान हैं, लेकिन आप लोग ये देखेंगे कि इसने एक दूसरे धारा के व्यक्ति ने एक निष्ठापूर्वक बौद्ध दर्शन के विषय में कुछ विचार किया है, चिंतन किया है, ये मेरे लिए प्लस पॉइंट ही होगा। ये थोड़ी सी मुझे समस्या यहाँ आ रही, एक तो हमने एक पॉइंट उठाया, हम लोग जब बौद्ध दर्शन का अध्ययन शुरू में ही जो जनरल धारा में करने के लिए उपस्थित होते हैं तो उसमें नास्तिक दर्शन आस्तिक दर्शन करके दो विभाग मिलता है सबसे पहले ही। आप देखते हैं भारतीय दर्शन चटर्जी एंड दत्त का, देखिए बलदेव उपाध्याय का, किसी का भी प्रसिद्ध लोगों का, तो नास्तिक दर्शन आस्तिक दर्शन। फिर नास्तिक दर्शन में चार्वाक जैन बौद्ध आएंगे, आस्तिक दर्शन में और दर्शनों का विवेचन आता है। इस पर हमने बड़ा काफ़ी विचार किया है आस्तिक नास्तिक क्या है, तो उसमें भी अंतिम में निष्कर्ष निकला कि किसी कहीं ईश्वर को लेकर के आस्तिक नास्तिक का विभाग है, कहीं कर्म फल को लेकर के है, कहीं पुनर्जन्म को लेकर के है। तो ऐसे दृष्टि से विचार करने पर कुछ जैसे सांख्य दर्शन है जहाँ ईश्वर का विचार नहीं है वो भी ईश्वर की दृष्टि से नास्तिक हो सकता है, मीमांसा में भी ईश्वर कर्तृत्व की बात नहीं है तो वो भी नास्तिक हो सकता है। इस प्रकार कई समस्याएं वहाँ उपस्थित होंगी। बौद्ध दर्शन में एक पुनर्जन्म सिद्धांत को माना गया है तो ये भी आस्तिक हो सकता है। न वयम नास्तिका करके चंद्रकीर्ति साहब ने कहा, चंद्रकीर्ति जी जो विद्वान हैं उन्होंने लिखा न वयम नास्तिका, ये अपने प्रसन्न पदा व्याख्या के किसी पंक्ति में है, न वयम नास्तिका। अस्तित्व शाश्वत ग्राहो नास्तित्वच्छेद दर्शनम तस्मात अस्तित्व नास्तित्व नास्त्रियेत विचक्षण, एक बौद्ध दर्शन का मत है। अस्ति ऐसा करना ये शाश्वतवाद का समर्थन होगा, नास्ति बोलना जो है चार्वाक दर्शन उच्छेदवाद होगा, इसीलिए अस्तित्व नास्तित्व के बीच में जो है सो बौद्ध दर्शन है, दोनों का आश्रय नहीं ग्रहण करना चाहिए। फिर आगे और ये प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद का ही साइड का विषय है ये, क्योंकि प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद का मतलब ऐसा मुझे जो समझ में आया कि ये पूरा कंप्लीट तत्व है। प्रतीत्यपाद समझ में आने का मतलब है कि सीधे हम बुद्ध बन जाएंगे, उससे नीचे में प्रतीत्यपाद समझ में आने वाला नहीं है। इसलिए हम लोग जो विचार करते हैं करते कराते हैं वो एक नीचे के लेवल में सोचते हैं कि प्रतीत्यपाद समझ में आ गया, लेकिन ये आने वाला तब तक नहीं है जब तक ये बुद्ध नहीं बनेंगे। विज्ञप्ति मात्रता सिद्धि में आचार्य वसुबंधु ने लिखा है, मैं नेगी जी को सुबह सुना रहा था, विज्ञप्ति मात्रता सिद्धि स्वशक्ति सदृशी मया कृतेयम सर्वथा सातु न चिंत्या बुद्ध गोचरा, लिखा है साफ साफ कि विज्ञप्ति मात्रता सिद्धि के ऊपर हमने बहुत बातें तो की हैं लेकिन ये चिंतन का विषय हमारे जैसे लोगों का नहीं है, ये तो बुद्ध गोचरो अयम विषय है, ये बुद्ध ही इसको समझ सकते हैं। इसे प्रतीत्यपाद का जो असली तात्पर्य है ये भगवान बुद्ध ही समझ सकते हैं, क्योंकि इसी को समझने के बाद बुद्धत्व प्राप्ति हुई थी। प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद समझने के बाद ही फिर उन्होंने कहा कि फिर संसार को जो है लोक बहुजन हिताय बहुजन सुखाय की बातें उसके बाद शुरू हुई है, तो बुद्धत्व प्राप्ति कराने का ये सिद्धांत है। लेकिन यहाँ हमने कुछ पॉइंट लिखा है, कुछ ये नेत्र में औषधि चल रही है इसलिए कुछ हमको समस्या है, लेकिन मैं पॉइंट पॉइंट बोलता हूँ समय के अंदर में। यह प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद शून्यताम ताम प्रचक्षम है सा प्रज्ञप्ति रूपादाय प्रतिपद शैव मध्यमा, ये संस्कृत बैकग्राउंड के तरफ से प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद मेरा आएगा। तो ये प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद जैसे विज्ञप्ति मन चित्तम क्या 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 सर्वम मन विज्ञप्ति, उसी के अनेक पर्यायवाची शब्द हैं, उसी प्रकार शून्यता प्रज्ञप्ति उपादाय मध्यमा प्रतिपद आदि जितने शब्द हैं वही प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद के ही ये पर्यायवाची हैं। यह प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद शून्यताम ताम प्रचक्षमहे। जैसे माया है, अध्यास है, भ्रम है, अज्ञान है, अनेक प्रकार के शब्द हैं अद्वैत वेदांत में, लेकिन सबका मतलब होता है माया, सबका मतलब होता है भ्रम, सबका मतलब होता है अज्ञान, वहाँ कुछ फर्क पड़ने वाला नहीं होता है, एक ही होता है। उसी प्रकार प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद का मतलब अब ये द्वादश भवचक्र जो हम लोग उधर जो है पहले बौद्ध संस्कार में नहीं आते थे, जो शुद्ध हिंदू में थे, हिंदू बौद्ध भी ये सब कल्पित चीजें हैं, न कोई हिंदू है न कोई बौद्ध है समझ में आने के बाद, लेकिन जो ऐसे जो घुमाया जाता है तो जो है द्वादश भवचक्र संसार परिवर्तनशील है, इसको बताने के लिए घुमाने का कंसेप्ट आया है करके कोई बताया था हमको बचपन में, तो बात तो सही है लगता है, क्योंकि ये जितने जो आपके ये जो क्या है जन्म जाति भव उपादान तृष्णा वेदना आदि का भवचक्र घूमता है, तो उसी का यंत्र बना करके हाथ में लेके हमेशा 24 घंटा जो है बौद्धानुयायी घुमाता है, तो समझता है कि संसार परिवर्तनशील है, सर्वम क्षणिकम सर्वम शून्यम सर्वम अनात्मम, ये बहुत बचपन में सुना था सर जी, फिर बाद में तो अब जो है जैसा भी हो, लेकिन ये द्वादश भवचक्र प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद, तो चूंकि विद्वानों के सामने बड़ा संक्षेप में बोलना है हमको कि प्रतिपति इत्यानाम समुत्पाद प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद, तो उसमें विपसा है कि नहीं है, बड़ा लंबा शास्त्रार्थ चंद्रकीर्ति जी का है, ये आप लोग सब जानते ही हैं, लेकिन अस्मिन सति इदम भवति जो कार्य कारण का सिद्धांत है वही प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद है। मैं इसको BHU में बोल रहा था तो कुछ वेदांती खड़े होकर के हमारा विरोध किए कि ये कैसे होगा, क्योंकि ये सर्वम क्षणिकम का सिद्धांत कैसे बनेगा, जैसे रेल की पटरी के ऊपर से रेल चलती है तो रेल तो ठीक है चलायमान है, लेकिन पटरी तो जो है स्थाई है, नीचे बैठी है उसके ऊपर, तभी रेल चल पाएगी। अब आपकी पटरी भी चलेगी, आपका ट्रेन भी चलेगा, तो आपका आपकी यात्रा गड़बड़ा जाएगी। वैसे ही सर्वम क्षणिकम है, कोई आपका आधार नहीं रहेगा कहीं भी, तो टिकना मुश्किल हो जाएगा। तो हमने उनको कहा कि ठीक से बुद्धिज्म पढ़िए, तो उसके बैकग्राउंड में ही उस तत्व को आप समझ सकते हैं, क्योंकि किसी बौद्ध संस्कार से भावित व्यक्ति को श्रीमद् भगवद गीता भी हम नहीं समझा सकते उसी तरह, क्योंकि एक लामा को मैं सर संपूर्णानंद में गीता पढ़ाया, वो पढ़ना चाहता था, तो कहा वो 3-4 अध्याय पढ़ाने के बाद अब हम लोग को तो बड़ा अच्छा लगता है, वो कहा गुरुजी ये कैसे होगा, ये तो सब गड़बड़ लग रहा है। तो हमने कहा कि ये गीता गड़बड़ नहीं है, तुम्हारा संस्कार गड़बड़ है। तो वैसे ही हम लोग का जब तक संस्कार ठीक नहीं होता है, पहले से दिमाग में कुछ रहेगा वो प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद जिंदगी भर समझ में आने वाला नहीं है। असली पॉइंट हम यहाँ देख रहे हैं। अब संक्षेप में एक दो चीज मैं बता देता हूँ। भगवान बुद्ध जो है तपस्या करने के पहले जो बुद्ध चरितम पर यदि हम विश्वास कर लें, यदि उसकी बात मानते हैं, तो वो बहुत सत्संग करते हैं, काफ़ी अरार कलाम आदि ऋषियों के पास जाते हैं, तत्व समझते हैं, तो जो अरार कलाम जी उपदेश देते हैं, थोड़ा सा बुद्ध को समझाते हैं, तो उसमें कुछ सांख्य दर्शन का कुछ झलक आता है, उसमें ध्यान देंगे बुद्ध चरितम देखेंगे तो लगता है कि कुछ सांख्य का असर उसमें है। भगवान बुद्ध जो है सर्वम दुखम सर्वम क्षणिकम सर्वम अनात्मम सर्वम शून्यम, ये जो दुखम अस्ति दुख कारणम अस्ति चार आर्य सत्य निकाले हैं, तो उसके पहले वो सांख्य सुन चुके थे, ये समझ लीजिएगा, समझ गए ना, तो उसका मॉडिफिकेशन उन्होंने किया है जो है, सो बाद में साधना में निकला तो ये चार आर्य सत्य निकले, और विज्ञप्ति मात्रता फिर चतुष्कोटि विनिर्मुक्तम शून्य तत्वम माध्यमिका जगु। मैं और पॉइंट में आता हूँ क्योंकि थोड़ा समय भी देखना है। अब जो है वो मूल माध्यमिक कारिका का हम सभी विद्वान लोग देखे ही हैं, उसमें लिखा है कि यह प्रतीत्य समुत्पादम पश्यतीदम सपश्यति दुखम समुदयम चैव निरोधम मार्गमेव च। जो प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद सिद्धांत को समझता है, अस्मिन् सति इदम् भवति अस्युत्पादात् इदम् उत्पद्यते कार्य कारण सिद्धांत से जुड़ा है, और कारण नाशात कार्य नाशः, ये सिद्धांत खैर और जगह भी चलता है चलने के लिए। तो अब कारण का नाश कर देंगे स्वतः कार्य का भी नाश हो जाएगा, इसीलिए दुख का कोई कारण है उसका नाश होना चाहिए, तो द्वादश भव चक्र से समझाया गया है ठीक ठाक से। और ये बाद में जब शास्त्रार्थ में चला गया तो थोड़ा सा उलझन का मैटर पड़ गया, जब भगवान बुद्ध का साक्षात उपदेश था तो बड़ा सरल सरल था, जब विद्वानों में शास्त्रार्थ होने लगा, केवल बौद्ध दर्शन की ही बात नहीं है, मैं जब ब्रह्मसूत्र और उपनिषद और श्रीमद् भगवद गीता वेदांत दर्शन के तीन मुख्य ग्रंथ हैं, इनको जब हमने पढ़ा तो कुछ हमें लगा कि वेदांत आने लगा, और उसके बाद चित्सुखी और अद्वैत सिद्धि और आगे के ग्रंथ पढ़ने लगा तो हमको लगा कि वेदांत उड़ गया, वेदांत का ब्रह्म गायब हो गया, मैं स्वतः अनुभव किया हूँ, आप लोग भी समझ सकते हैं। इतना शास्त्रार्थ आ जाएगा न्यायामृता द्वैत सिद्धि और अद्वैत सिद्धि में कि आपका सारा का सारा हिल जाएगा सब कुछ जो है। तो जो ओरिजिनल बात है उसमें आपको तुरंत जो है दिल में वो प्रभाव डालता है, वैसे ही बुद्ध के वचन है। तो अब यहाँ जो है प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद को समझाने के लिए आगे कहा, सर्वम च युज्यते तस्य शून्यता यस्य युज्यते, प्रतीत्यपाद और शून्यता एक ही चीज है, सर्वम न युज्यते तस्य शून्यम यस्य न युज्यते, जिसको ये फिट नहीं बैठता है उसको कुछ नहीं फिट बैठेगा। प्रतीत्यपाद समझ में आ जाएगा तो सब कुछ समझ में आ जाएगा। यह प्रत्यय जायति स ह्यजातो, अब जो कार्य कारण से उत्पन्न होकर के जो है, जैसे गंदगी फैली तो आपका डेंगू का मच्छर फैला या जो कुछ हुआ बीमारी हुई, यदि वो सफाई रहेगी तो आपका वहाँ कुछ नहीं मच्छर फैलता है, वहाँ डेंगू नहीं होता है। अमेरिका में बातचीत होती है तो लोग कहते हैं डेंगू क्या होता है, बहुत से लोग जानते नहीं है, लेकिन अब बनारस में जो है उसका कार्य कारण हो गया, वो डेंगू फैल गया। तो अब ये यह प्रत्यय जायति स ह्यजातो न तस्य उत्पाद स्वभावतोस्ति, यह प्रत्ययाधीनु स शून्य उक्तो यह शून्यताम जानति स्वप्रमत्तः, जो इसको जानता है वो अप्रमत्त होता है, वो ज्ञानी होता है। मैं अध्यक्ष जी अत्यंत शॉर्ट कर दे रहा हूँ, कोई समस्या नहीं होगी। अब इसका जो है एक हम बहुत अपनी बात भी हम नहीं कहते हैं, इसलिए प्रश्न उश्न कोई होगा तो हमको समस्या नहीं है कि क्योंकि हम शास्त्र की ही बात करेंगे, हम एकदम इसका निष्कर्ष निकाल देते हैं जो मध्यमक शास्त्र में लिखा है प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद को लेकर के। हमारे नक्षत्र प्रसाद जी प्रोफेसर कहीं होंगे, इसके बाद वो पाली की दृष्टि से देंगे। तस्मात यस्य इयम शून्यता रोचते, अब इससे बढ़िया हम लोग अपना क्या बनाएंगे, यस्य इयम शून्यता रोचते तस्य प्रतीत्य समुत्पादो युज्यते, जिसको शून्यता समझ में आएगी उसी को प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद जो है समझ में आएगा। यस्य प्रतीत्य समुत्पादो युज्यते तस्य चत्वारी आर्य सत्तानि युज्यन्ते, जिसको प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद समझ में आएगा चार आर्य सत्य भी उसे समझ में आएगा। यस्मात् कथम कृत्वा यस्मात् प्रतीत्य समुत्पन्नम ही दुःखम भवति न प्रतीत्य समुत्पन्नम तच्च निस्वाभावात् शून्यम सति च दुखे दुख समुदयो दुख निरोधो दुख निरोध गामिनी च प्रतिपद युज्यते ततश्च दुख परिज्ञानम दुख प्रहाणम निरोध साक्षात्करणम मार्ग भावना च युज्यते सति च दुखादि सत्य परिज्ञानादिकम फलानि युज्यन्ते सत्सु च फलेषु फलस्था युज्यन्ते सत्सु च फलस्थेषु प्रतिपन्नता युज्यन्ते प्रतिपन्नका युज्यन्ते सत्सु च प्रतिपन्नक फलेषु संघो युज्यते, तब संघ भी फिट बैठेगा। आर्य सत्वानां च सद्भावे सद्धर्मोपि युज्यते सति च सद्धर्मे संघे बुद्धोपि युज्यते ततश्च त्रिण्यपि रत्नानि युज्यन्ते लौकिक लोकोत्तराश्च पदार्थाः सर्वे विशेषाधिगमा युज्यन्ते धर्माधर्मौ तत्फलं सुगति दुर्गति लौकिकाश्च सर्वसद्व्यवहारा युज्यन्ते तदेवं सर्वं च युज्यते तस्य शून्यता यस्य युज्यते, निष्कर्ष है। अब मैं अपने मन से निष्कर्ष दे देता हूँ, यहाँ पर आठ विशेषण हैं, हाँ बस वही कर रहे हैं अब, आई एम गोइंग टू कंक्लूड कि ये जो आठ अष्ट विशेषण हैं अनिरोधम अनुत्पादम अनुच्छिन्नम अशाश्वतम, अब इनका ठीक से अध्ययन कर लिया जाए तो प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद फिर समझ में आ जाएगा। और इतना सरल होता तो फिर इतनी किताबें नहीं लिखनी पड़ती। हमने पहले ही कह दिया कि वेदांत का ब्रह्म और यहाँ की शून्यता और प्रतीत्य समुत्पाद, उसी को समझाने के लिए सारे ग्रंथों का प्रणयन हुआ, लंबी लंबी साधनाएं करनी पड़ी। हम लोग चिंतन मनन विचार करते रहें, दो कदम उसमें आगे बढ़े, बुद्ध की कृपा होगी तो कुछ न कुछ जरूर समझ में आएगा। इसी के साथ मैं अध्यक्ष जी एवं समस्त श्रोताओं को भी प्रणाम करते हुए विराम लेता हूँ। धन्यवाद, नमो नमः।
थैंक यू प्रोफेसर अधिकारी फॉर योर वेरी वेरी इन्फॉर्मेटिव लेक्चर। नाउ वी हैव सम टाइम फॉर डिस्कशन, सो कपल ऑफ क्वेश्चंस आई एम इनवाइटिंग फ्रॉम द ऑडियंस।
अलग अलग दृष्टियों से सोचने के अलग अलग जो एंगल हैं उसके हिसाब से बुद्ध को या बौद्ध धर्म को नास्तिक कहा गया। जहाँ तक मनुस्मृति की बात है, नास्तिको वेद निंदक है, में उन्होंने सिर्फ यही कहा कि जो वेद की निंदा करने वाला है वो नास्तिक है। और हम पूरा जितना तक हम लोग अध्ययन किए हैं उसमें कहीं ऐसा नहीं आया कि वेद की निंदा किया हो बुद्ध ने। अब ठीक है कि उसके जो सिद्धांत है उसके समकक्ष इन्होंने अलग से अपने सिद्धांत का प्रतिपादन किया है, तो फिर भी जो है बुद्ध को नास्तिक, बुद्ध के धर्म को नास्तिक धर्म के रूप में क्यों कुछ लोग मानते हैं, जबकि सबकी सोच एकांगी है।
ये हमारा ही मत है। हरिओम। ये जो आपने कहा बहुत सही है। बुद्ध, भगवान बुद्ध ने तो बहुम पीछे संगीताम भाषमाणो न तक करो होति नरो प्रमित्त गोपो व गावम गणयन परेशाम। दूसरे के गाय गिनने वाले गोप के समान होगा जो संगीता पढ़ के उसके समान आचरण नहीं करेगा। बहुत प्रशंसा की है। लेकिन जो परंपरा में कहीं कहीं जैसे धर्मकीर्ति हैं, धर्मकीर्ति जी ने ध्वस्तलिंगानम ध्वस्त प्रज्ञानम पंचलिंगानि जाड्ढे कहा, सांख्यों ने भी बहुत आलोचना किया, तो मैं यही बात को पंडित के सभाओं में उठाता हूँ रामरक्षित प्रसाद जी, आदरणीय प्रसाद जी, और वहाँ हमारे ऊपर आक्रमण होते हैं, लेकिन इसी धारा को लेके मैं वहाँ चलता हूँ कि ये जो नास्तिकता का पैमाना है, नास्तिको वेद निंदक इतने ही नहीं है। अस्ति नास्ति दिष्टम मति ही पाणिनि, एक पाणिनि का सूत्र है सर, अस्ति नास्ति दिष्टम मति, उसमें लिखा है साफ साफ, अस्ति परलोके मति यस्य सः आस्तिकः, नास्ति परलोके मति यस्य सः नास्तिकः। इसीलिए मेरे हृदय में ऐसा आता है कि बुद्ध जो है नास्तिक नहीं है, उनको नास्तिक नहीं मानना चाहिए। धन्यवाद।
पंडित जी, आपने आस्तिक नास्तिक बौद्धों को नास्तिक कहा, बौद्ध धर्म पुनर्जन्म को मानते हैं और निर्वाण को मानते हैं, कर्मफल को मानते हैं, इस दृष्टि से तो बौद्ध तो नास्तिक नहीं है। अच्छा, वेद को भी निंदा नहीं करते हैं, शब्द प्रमाण का खंडन करते हैं, शब्द जो अनित्य होता है वो नित्य नहीं है, और दूसरे आत्मा अनात्मा की बात है, चार प्रकार के आत्मा का विश्लेषण किया। एक है परिकल्पित आत्मा जो कपिल मुनि का है, पांच लक्षण से युक्त, नंबर एक। दूसरे जो है साझा आत्मा, दूसरा। तीसरा है अनिर्वचन आत्मा, चौथा है व्यावहारिक आत्मा। तो सबसे पहले परिकल्पित आत्मा है वो सांख्य कपिल मुनि जी का है, उसे बौद्धों से कोई लेना देना नहीं, उनका ना खंडन करता कुछ करता है। और निर्वचन आत्मा जो है वत्सी पुत्र है, वैभाषिक दर्शन के अंदर एक विद्वान था, उनका था। आत्मा या नित्य है ना अनित्य है, अनिर्वचन है, मुंह से नहीं बोल सकता है, तो एक इसको भी मानते हैं। सबसे खतरनाक जो है साझा आत्मा, जन्म से लेकर के मनुष्य हो चाहे कीड़े, वो सब में अहम की बोध होता है, उसको छोड़ना सबसे कठिन काम है। और चौथा है व्यावहारिक आत्मा, मैं खाता हूँ, मैं बीमार हूँ, मैं बोलता हूँ जाता है, ये तो सिर्फ काम चलाओ के लिए है। अब ये चार आत्माओं में से आपका कौन कर बौद्ध जो आत्मा है नहीं, इन चारों को समझना बहुत जरूरी है सबके लिए। मैं कर रहा
ऐसा है कि समय तो बीत गया, और
परिकल्पित आत्मा का जो
जो आपने कहा सर
जी,
वो घुमा फिरा के सब हमारी बात आपने कही है कि नहीं, क्योंकि मैं बोल चुका था यहाँ से, वही उसी की व्याख्या प्रोफेसर मैंने छोपेल जी टशी पलजोर जी ने किया है, तो आपको बहुत बहुत प्रणाम है। जैसा आप मान रहे हैं वैसा ही मेरा भी मत है। धन्यवाद।
सो एनी अदर क्वेश्चन? या ओके
गुरु जी, मैं सीधा सीधा पूछती हूँ, शून्यता और ब्रह्म एक ही चीज है या नहीं? यदि एक ही चीज नहीं है तो इसका भेद बता दीजिएगा।
इसका भेद बता दीजिए, वाह क्या बात है, शून्यता और ब्रह्म बहुत गंभीर पूछी। अब विपस्यना और करिए, कई विपस्यना कर चुकी हैं, क्योंकि शून्यता और ब्रह्म दोनों एक ही चीज है। बता देता हूं उनको मैं एक लाइन में। शून्यता का लक्षण क्या है, किसी ने पूछा, कहा कि वो अनिर्वचनीय है, वो वाणी का विषय नहीं है। और ब्रह्म का लक्षण क्या है, ब्रह्म का लक्षण भी यन मनसा न मनुते ये नाहुर मनोमतम तदेव ब्रह्मत्वम विद्धि नेदम यदि तम उपासते, वो भी वाणी का विषय नहीं है। दोनों ये वाणी के विषय नहीं है, इसीलिए दोनों एक है। ताली बजाइए, हो गया ना बस।
सो इफ देयर इज नो अदर क्वेश्चन, थैंक्स हिम अगेन, ओके, एंड वी विल इनवाइट नेक्स्ट स्पीकर प्रोफेसर मंगला चिंचोरे। शी इज सीनियर ICPR फेलो एंड शी इज वेरी वेल नोन टू द ऑडियंस आई थिंक। सो
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी थैंक सारनाथ Central Institute of Higher Tibetan Studies, because last so many years, they are at least 4 years, they are inviting in different capacities for me here, but I couldn't come. And this time again they have invited, and I took it as a challenge, and I am here. Secondly, I am thankful to all of you for coming here, and after lunch also asking serious questions. So I am also failing to talk on the subject given to me. I am first, let me also respect the elderly persons here on the dais, of the dais, and also the younger generation, which is very much enthusiastic and seriously interested in Buddhist studies. Now, in between the two elderly generations and the youngers, I'm standing here to express my views. The subject which was, or the topic which was given to me in the letter was three characteristics according to Vijnanavada. So already the topic is given, and since I am considering myself as a student of philosophy, and I have the habit, as very many times I have stated, that whenever any topic comes to me, I erase first my all the knowledge, because we have the presumption that we know everything, or we have learned something earlier, and that is something which we should talk about. But I have the habit to prick the balloon of my own ego first, if at all it is there. And hence, I raise the question, three questions, as a student of philosophy first. What it is, why it is, and how it is. When we raise these three questions, and especially with reference to Vijnanavada and three characteristics, naturally, I have to go to the entire beginning or origination of the things. Obviously, three characteristics, that is, I think they wanted to say three swabhava. And Trisvabhava is not available anywhere in early Buddhism, the way in which it is, though discussion is there, but seeds are there, I am going to come to it. But the entire doctrine of Trisvabhava came to the foreground, at, I think, starting from Mahayana literature itself. So it is within the Buddhism. Again, it is within the Mahayana tradition, and here I would like to little bit request you to pay attention to three important things. Is Vijnanavada only available without any kind of reference to any tradition? No. Vijnanavada could be interpreted in three different frameworks, namely Vijnanavada of Yogacara, Vijnanavada of Sautrantikas, and Vijnanavada of Vaibhashikas. According to me, there are differences in between the three. Now, let me read some part because that is something which is important, and then I will give the reasons behind the emergence of Triswabhava in Yogacara Vijnanavada and what are its present implications or what is its present relevance and significance that we will come to. So, in the introduction, let me first read some of the pages which are already circulated or available in the written paper. After Parinirvana of the Buddha, in the changing circumstances and situations, in order to adjust or adopt and adapt amicably with the non-Buddhist traditions externally and modify internally for the followers within Buddhism, having varied interest, change of framework, and innovative interpretation of the thoughts of the Buddha was essential. So on the one hand, I am trying to connect it with non-Buddhist traditions as well as early Buddhist traditions too. According to the entire thing will be on the historical background of Indian philosophical traditions, then prevalent and also having changing phases during the 2500 years. This need perhaps was realized by the later followers, and to combat with the then twin challenge was various new concepts, thoughts, ideas were articulated. It was practical side to preserve and protect Buddha's thoughts in the then prevalent challenging situation or perhaps in adverse conditions also, and change both structurally and constitutively to grow was the need of the day. One thing is noticeable in the history of Buddhism that thoughts of the Buddha never are given up by any thinker or follower individually or collectively from any sect, subsect, school or tradition. Buddhism has undergone various transformations at various stages, and yet basic categories of the teaching of the Buddha, namely anityata, dukkha, anatmata and nirvana, they are everywhere. In each book you will find they are explained, enumerated, and also its relevance is explained, analyzed by each one in a different way. It is not the same explanation, please note. It is not the same interpretation and explanation which is coming forward. At every philosopher, even his own works, you will find different interpretations, but they are interconnected, but they don't have uniformity. There is unity, consistency, yes, but there is no uniformity. Repetition of words is not the business of Buddhism. They have novelty at each point. That is something which is uniqueness of Buddhism. Remain the same. Only one thing is there. Consistent interpretational changes. Something due to external pressures or else internal compulsions. Because some controversies were there. Some doubts were raised either internally or some opposition was there externally, and hence they were required to give a different interpretation, and hence a different work is written for them. Even while introducing novel thoughts, ideas, generally, each tradition, school, sect, subsect, each follower in particular and his numerous works even written specifically have not remained the static, permanent, presenting the same ideas. Their thrust, focus, perspective, background of emergence, rationale behind, and the significance all may be different. Still, general framework is the same. For fulfilling the quest of the followers, use of skills and skills of thoughts and expressions, various aspects are highlighted. Rather, they were committed to their own foundations, depicting continuity of thoughts and practices, but novelty in articulation is expressed in each work, small or big. Thus, Hinayana, better put, Shravakayana and Pratyeka Buddhayana. I don't like to use the word Hinayana. In no way it is Hina, because seeds are there in the early Buddhist tradition, the so-called Hinayana. Need not be excluded in the new changed setup. Instead, the earlier religious, moral, spiritual practices on the one hand and concepts, thoughts, ideas on the other are to be incorporated within, seems to be realized by the Mahayanists. They were more keen on philosophical explanation in modified, altered framework. Instead of earlier religious and a peculiarly individualistic, giving new twist and turn to the growth and development in Buddhism was essential. Historically, in early Buddhism, 18 sects were prevalent, having various differences within. To them, using social, psychological aspect of human personality, a wider holistic framework is provided by Mahayana. In Mahayana, both rationality as well as, I will not say irrationality, but non-rationality, spiritual, moral, religious principles which are hidden in subconscious level is something which is importantly used by Mahayana, some traditions. In earlier form, religious practices for individual perfection to get ideal state of nirvana were emphasized. Generally, religion is based on faith or fear of human beings to protect and preserve psychophysical existence and to progress in life morally and spiritually. A new extension and enlargement exercise was undertaken by Mahayana and is preserved and focused in the shifted epistemological and cultural aspect to adjust with socio-political, economic conditions prevalent at that time. This insightful transformation attempted to preserve cohesiveness and to develop an attitude to change in order to adjust with the situation prevailed is discernible. For example, in Saddharma Pundarika Sutra, it is stated that it is essential to unite various yanas by combining all the modes of practices and thoughts. Eka yana for progress of you all universally. This universality is in different way interpreted in Mahayana. Though sarvam dukkham, sarvam anityam, sarvam anatmam, this sarva was there even in Pali literature emphasized, but now here a different turn is given. Instead of sarva only restricting to human life and various aspects at various stages, instead of that, all universally, this all irrespective of any kind of differences, this something is very important in Mahayana. Generally, it is held that philosophically, systematic presentation of Mahayana begins with the founder, Nagarjuna, who formulated Madhyamic thoughts logically to avoid exclusion and extremism, which was emerging, or at least some of the sects out of the 18 sects, some of the sects were trying to be a little bit deviating tendencies are shown and extremist forms are undertaken to avoid that. He emphasized on the importance of Madhyama Pratipat, middle path, on both the levels of reality. It is not only Samruddhi Sat, but even Paramartha Sat to attain Nirvana. However, we are told by various historians in common that common masses were remain having the gap between elites and them. And to fill up the gap, linking theory with moral, religious, moral, spiritual practices prevalent and concentrating on common man's psyche, this was essential. And this gap is seen by Mahayana tradition very importantly, taking into consideration variety of individuals and their mindsets, variety of dispositions and potentialities and differences of abilities and preconditions, and also their plight, their goals and aspirations. It was essential that when they are confronting actual life and responding to various situations, that gap-filling exercise was undertaken by Mahayana by providing certain important clues which are to be adopted by one according to his freedom of choice. It appears that Yogacara has given that, has performed that act of gap-filling. Madhyamic tradition, it appears, gave primacy to theorization and systematization of the thoughts very rationally and logically. Instead, Yogacara attempted and emphasized primarily on practices, though theoretical understanding is not altogether neglected by Yogacara, nor Madhyamikas have given holiday to practices as well. So there is, but primacy, that is something which is different. On this general background of origination of Yogacara, I wish to begin my inquiry in a reverse sequential order of the title, that is Yogacara, Triswabhava of Yogacara Vijnanavada. I wish to begin my inquiry first with 3 points here are considered. Philosophical contributions of Yogacara Buddhism, meaning of Vijnanavada, and then doctrine of Triswabhava. In the first section, I will undertake that. Yogacara Buddhism, as the word Yogacara indicates, emphasis is on achara, definitely and obviously. Practicing integration in life. It is not at the fag end only you can develop, grow or progress, but at each moment you show your characteristic acts through which you have improved is clear. So human beings, whether they are progressing or not, is not something which is having a stages or static mode of evaluation, but at each mode, even in childhood, we are evaluated, and that is something constant evaluation which keeps us awake. So it is integration morally, spiritually, psychophysically, culturing and nurturing of human beings for legitimate goals. Please note legitimate. Any goal will not be permissible because that may also be non-conducive or hindrance to others. And hence, what should I do and what should I aspire for is already determined by the kind of my own setup inside as well as society, if I am progressing and using my freedom, I should not use the freedom of others as my means. Yes, yes. It is not merely theoretical analysis to comprehend the truth suffices for any and every aspirant, but actual use of it in life. And that's why we find that yogacharins are trying to emphasize on not only, and all the Buddhists in Mahayana tradition, they are not only emphasizing on anuloma type of ashtangika marga, but even pratiloma, that is much more important. And while performing the pratiloma type of ashtangika marga, it is not the self-centered attitude or interest in self to be having bodhi, illumination, but it is the interest of the society at large. So all human beings, they should also be enlightened. That is my wishful thinking. Now, since I have already been given warning, so I have to be little bit short. In Yogacharya and also Mahayana tradition, Sambhara Marga, Prayoga Marga, Darshana Marga, Bhavana Marga and Ashaiksha Marga, five margas, modes of leading towards Bodhi are being given. Still, it is Bhavana Marga and Ashaiksha Marga which is much more emphasized by Vijnanavadins, which we will come to. Yogacharya Vijnanavada, because as I have told, Vijnanavada is of three kinds, but I have to restrict to Yogacharya. Now here also, we have been told that Tri Svabhava, Tri Kaya, Alay Vijnana and Vijnapti Matrata are the four important doctrines which have been given by Vijnanavada and Yogacharya in particular. Now, with this, I wish to now come to that Vijnana means what? The meaning of it is veridical, particular perception. Here, there is a marked difference between Vijnana and Jnana. Here, Vijnana is something, my cognition of a particular specific thing or being, which is given to me in a specific way. So my cognition, as I have a particular angle, focus, thirst, perspective or background, that differs. Similarly, you will find that my bodhi also will be different. There are three kinds of bodhis which have been given and discussed by yogacharins, especially in Abhidharma Samuchaya. We find discussion of three kinds of bodhis. Now coming to the second point, that jnana is something which is general, available to all. Now here exactly the difference between, I have made it, but I am not going to read it. There is a difference between Vedantins and Buddhists. Vedantins are saying that vijnana is something which is available to all, whereas jnana is something my own, and that is Brahma jnana. But here Buddhists are saying that I have a vijnana means what I have understood, my comprehension. That is different from others' comprehension, and that's why what we have is different. Now coming to second point in this discussion, there is a difference between vijnapti and vijnana, which I have made. I have said that vijnana is something which, just as I have it, it is momentary, it is for the time being subjective in its incidence, but when I try to communicate, I have to use words, express it, and hence for sharing my cognition, intersubjectivity will be required, and hence it will be a different one. Now coming to the third. Chitta and Chaitasika also I have made the difference. Sorry. Manas, Chitta and Vijnana, according to me, as I have found in various books, it is not the same. And that's why we have to use it in a different manner. Now coming to Parikalpita, this is the uniqueness of Yogacara Vijnanavada. According to me, Vijnanavada was not much more important for giving Parinishpanna, which is Paramartha Sat. It is also not much important for giving Paratantra, which was Samruddhi Sat, because Jnana, Jnata, all the things will come there. Karta, Karma, all these things are five kinds of discriminations which we make on that level. They are Samruddhi Sat, as we have been told. But much more importantly, Parikalpita is something which is a unique contribution of Yogacara, Vijnanavada, in the Tri Swabhava doctrine. What is meant by Parikalpita? Generally, we have been told that it is something which is illusory, which is appearance, and hence it is something which is not conducive to our bodhi. But I have found that in Abhidharma Samuchya, Mahayana Sutra Alankar, as well as Madhyanta Vibhaga Shastra, all the three texts I am using, and there I have found that Parikalpita has an important role to play to begin with. Why it is enumerated with first position and not the last position? Because it has something to do with the limits of our conceivability, and Parinishpanna is something ultimately we have to arrive at. That is our ultimate understanding or comprehension of the ultimate truth, Bodhi. So Bodhi is something which is connecting link between conceivability and actuality, the way we experience it. And hence, ultimate point, once we go to that, so beginning is Parikalpita, but end point, according to Yogacara, Tri Swabhava, I think is also Parikalpita, because we have to come down to the level of common masses. Buddhism has, especially Mahayana tradition, has not said that give up your profession, give up your family life and join Buddha Sangha. Rather, do your profession, but identify yourself completely, erasing your ego, and be completely one with the thing that you are doing, and then only you can experience Bodhi also. This is a different interpretation which is not available anywhere. Why they have given it? We find again that at that time, the clash between Bhikshu Sangha, who were living in monasteries and having sacred life, whereas masses which were having household life, they need to be conjoined, and they also need to be given importance to. And that is how Tri Swabhava starts with Parikalpita and ends with Parikalpita. And hence, this doctrine is something which is very important, not only for Yogacara and Vijnanavada, but entire Mahayana tradition, to such an extent that the way in which we find Ashwaghosha is trying to say that even Jnana and your own Bhavana, they need to be melt. When only you melt them to that point of your existence, here ontological, continuity, substantiality, all are irrelevant and futile discussions. This merging point is something which is very important. Dissolving your identity in the work that you are doing is something very importantly emphasized, and that has influenced Ashwaghosha to all later on in aesthetics, art, and various kinds of modes of living life expressed in cultural forms. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I am thankful to all the audience. for patient listening.
We have few minutes only for discussions. Maybe one question. Yeah.
Suppose I have understood like this. If I take Nagarjuna across the board, he talks of Sarvadrishti Prahan and Nisobhata on the one hand, across the board. On the other hand, if I take Asanga and Vasubandhu, the later Vasubandhu, and if I say, suppose I change the title of your paper.
No.
Suni ji, question hai. Aapka samman karte ho. If I say, Tri Niso Bhavata, it's not. Ek Niso Bhavata ki baat kiya Nagarjuna ne, Vasubandhu ne teen Sobhavata dal di. Aisa lagta hai ki dono jo hai, अगर इतना ही रुक जाते हैं बड़ी खतरनाक स्थिति हो जाती है बुद्धिज्म के अंदर ही क्योंकि लेकिन मैं अगर कहूं कि निस्वभाव स्वभाव जो है अल्टीमेटली इट गेट्स कन्वर्टेड इनटू थ्री निस्वभावता एंड देयर इज अ पर्पस वन निस्वभावता थ्री स्वभावता एंड देन थ्री निस्वभाव How to deal with all this situation, which is very, very conflicting.
While we, since I cannot read all the paper, in my paper I have written that there are three kinds of shunyata. And when we are trying to have three swabhava doctrine properly growing, here I am not talking about the Bodhi directly having spontaneously, but a gradual progress of a common man at every moment. Masses, that is in front of all the Mahayana traditions and Yogacharya. By following a particular path, they are trying to say that at each moment, we are erasing something, the negative points which are there. So, Nisvabhavata of or shunyata of those negative points and positively we will be having bodhi also of three points, three different kinds. That is what is available in Abhidharma Samuchya.
So,
thank you very much.
Yeah, because and now we have the third speaker, Professor Kuntala Bhattacharya. She is from Rabindra Bharati University, Calcutta.
Respected Vice Chancellor Professor Samthen and respected Chairperson Professor Roy and very distinguished audience. Now the title of my paper is Looking Deep into Existence, the Yogacara Doctrine of the Three Natures. As you understand, there is very little left to say after Professor Mangala Chincho's truly enlightening talk, which covered perhaps everything I could ever think of saying on this topic. So, however, since I have been entrusted with this task of following her up, I, with my limited abilities, would try to discuss some implications. In fact, I would try to give a brief description of the doctrine of the three natures and would also try to focus on the epistemological and soteriological implications of this doctrine, which influenced later Yogacara literature. I'm skipping the historical details, but I would like to mention that after the Second Buddhist Council, there was a rift in the Buddhist Sangha, which eventually led to the emergence of 18 Buddhist sects. And from the Mahasanghika sect, the Mahayana school of thought, it emerged. And these Mahayanis, they put up a doctrine quite different from the earlier Abhidharmikas in many ways. And they also claim that their understanding was backed, as the Abhidharmikas also claimed. The Mahayanis also claimed that their understanding was backed by the Buddha Vachanas, which eventually came to be known as the Prajnaparamita literature. Now, the Prajnaparamita literature emphasized on the doctrine of emptiness. And as we all know, the Madhyamikas, they took this doctrine of emptiness at its face value and tried to build a philosophical justification for it. But afterwards, around 2nd century CE, several Mahayana sutras began to appear, which preferred a less rigid version of the doctrine of emptiness. The most famous was the Sandhi Nirmochana Sutra, which claimed that the Buddha's earlier teaching of the emptiness of the dharmas should not be taken in their literal sense. Their deeper meaning is drawn out, niyatha, in the Sandhi Sutra itself, which is the final teaching of the Buddha. Now, the key concepts defining this early Yogacara thought, I'm emphasizing this early Yogacara thought because there was a distinct trend which we can see in the later Yogacara thought. Now, this early Yogacara thought, the key concepts defining this thought were the notions of cognition only, that is Bijgupti Matrata, the three self natures, three Svabhava, and also store consciousness or Alaya Vijnanam. Now, the first notion, it clearly states that according to the Yogacara, all ontologies are epistemological constructions. Therefore, to understand how cognition operates is to understand how and why people construct the ontology which they cling to. And this is exactly why the notion of store consciousness is introduced, that is to explain the mechanism of mind which gives rise to such constructions. Now, here the Yogacara may face questions like, what is the status of the entities which are mistaken for the world, which are our constructions? This third notion, that means the doctrine of the three natures, have been introduced to provide an answer to this question. What is the nature of the entities that build up the world? Now, the prerequisite for understanding the three natures is therefore having at least a preliminary grasp over the main contentions of the consciousness-only theory and the subsequent notion of store consciousness. In Vijgupti Matrata Siddhi, Trinshika Karika, Vasubandhu says that the impositions of self or Atman and entities or Dharma, which develop in so many different ways, take place in the mode of consciousness. So everything is the mode or parinama of consciousness, and a mode is defined as that which has the property of being different, annathatva, or more specifically, it is the actualization of an effect at a moment distinct from the moment at which the cause of that effect is produced, and also which is identical with that moment in which the cause ceases to be. For the Yogacara, due to matured impressions, there arise false notions of self. Now, this self is the content part of consciousness. This is the akara, as bearing a name and as being completely different from consciousness. It's really a mode of consciousness, but it appears as if it is distinct from consciousness. Now, similarly, matured impressions may also give rise to dharmas like matter, which is also the content part of consciousness. But these consciousness, matter consciousness, as like self-consciousness, it is denoted by a name and known also like self-consciousness, as if external to consciousness. Now, in spite of the fact that whatever the self and matter both are modes of consciousness, so the knowables can have three natures. Now we are giving the description of these constructions. What we know, or what are the modes of consciousness? The three natures, the imaginary, that is parikalpita, the dependent, or the paratantra, and absolute, or the parinishpanna. Of these, the dependent nature is that which appears. It is so called because it exists depending on causes. But given that dependent nature is that which appears, the question would be, what is it that appears? The Yogacara answers that it is the unreal mental construction, as we have already understood. It is asatkalpa which appears, or to say more elaborately, any representation which is produced leaves in store consciousness an impression or vasana. Now these impressions remain in the store consciousness in a latent subliminal form until under certain conditions they reactualize themselves and produce new conscious representations similar to those by which the impressions were left. The term asatkalpa refers to these representations, ideas or cognitions which are originated by the reactualization of the impressions. These representations are what appear, and therefore dependent nature designates these entire representations, ideas or cognitions. Now it was seen that the representations are essentially of two classes, that corresponding to ego consciousness, that is of a me which experiences, and that corresponding to function consciousness, that is of beings as sattva, the things which are, and things or artha which are experienced. Now the first reason why are we calling this image or the dependent nature asatkalpa? Now because the representations are asatkalpa because this image of mind does not correspond to its true being. In other words, also mind is conceived as a real ego which grasps an equally real object. Its true nature is absence of subject-object duality. Now, secondly also, it is called asatkalpa because the objects of representations which present themselves as external to the mind do not exist at all, or are imaginations produced by the impressions and are without any corresponding real object. Now the imaginary nature is the form under which the dependent nature appears. It was seen that dependent nature necessarily presents itself with duality that is composed of the subject which knows as opposed to an object which is known. Duality again has inherent in it certain other imaginations, namely externality. Whatever we see, we imagine it as external to my consciousness. So externality, bajhyatya, and denotativeness, or obhilapyatya, nameability. Such duality, along with its inherent imaginations, constitutes the imaginary nature. It is called imaginary because no true reality corresponds to duality and its subordinate properties. Now the absolute nature, the dependent and the imaginary nature, and then the absolute nature, clearly it's the eternal non-being of the form which what appears assumes. That which appears is the dependent nature, as the way in which the dependent nature appears is the subject-object duality. The absolute reality is the non-existence of duality of the dependent nature. This third nature is called absolute because it is immutable, it has always been, it is and will always be the same thing, the inexistence of duality. Now an analogy may be drawn to make clear the meaning of the three natures. We all know the analogy of the magician who by reciting a spell conjures up a form of an elephant in the spectator's mind, when in fact there is only wood in front of the spectator. He makes elephant out of the wood. In the example, the elephant under whose form the magical creation appears corresponds to the imaginary nature. What the spell produces in the spectator's mind, namely the representation, corresponds to the dependent nature. The eternal non-existence of the real elephant in all this magical process corresponds to the absolute nature. The chants of the magician correspond to store consciousness because just like store consciousness, which creates a dependent nature, the chants create illusions. And lastly, the piece of wood on which the form of the elephant is superimposed corresponds to tathata or true reality. In both of these cases, there is only one real thing, the piece of wood in the case of magical demonstration, the non-duality in the case of three natures. Now, we come to the later Yogacara phase. We know that the Yogacara tradition was sharply demarcated by two distinct phases. The earlier conservative tradition, which relied mostly on the scriptures, which is Agamanusarin Yogacharin, and the later rationalist tradition, or the Nayanusarin, those who depended mostly on reason. They are known as the Agamanusarin. And Basubandhu, whose Trisvabhava Nirdesha we refer to while describing the nature, the three natures, belong to the earlier Yogacara tradition, that means to the earlier conservative tradition. The rationalist phase began with Dingnaga, but with Dharmakirti it gained a more solid ground. Now, in spite of the fact that these two traditions differ, the rationalist differed in many ways, and most of all here, what is important is that the rationalist or the later Yogacharins, they sometimes refused to accept the existence of Alaya Vijkano, which, according to the earlier Yogacharins, was responsible for generating dependent nature. And on these later Yogacharins, Dharmakirti was the most influential person to mold the later Yogacharin thought. And it was Dharmakirti's Pramana Vartika, which led to the later division of the Yogacharins into Sakaravada and Nirakaravada, which we will be referring to in relation to this doctrine of the three natures. Now, the 11th century Buddhist philosopher Janishrimitra wrote a treatise consisting of 6 chapters to support the idea that consciousness is imbued with content. And I'm grateful to Professor Gokhale for kindly guiding me through this text of Janishrimitra. Now, in this 6 chapters, the opponent whom he intended to defend his own thesis from was Buddhist idealist Ratnakara Shanti. Ratnakara and Janishrimitra were contemporaries, both belonged to the Vikramshila Mahavihar, and both of the 11th century. Ratnakara has argued that consciousness ultimately exists, but must be understood to be contentless. Consciousness is not constitutively intentional, it is nirakara. One should note that behind this idea is the assumption that consciousness is not identical with its content. And this is in direct contrast to the Sahupalambha Niyama that tries to establish that consciousness and its content are identical. We all know of Sahupalambha Niyama of Dharmakirti, which was formulated in Pramana Vartika, where he says that since consciousness and the object are both known at the same time, they are never known separably, both are identical with each other. Now, Ratnakara's argument is consciousness and its content are different because, for example, blue as the content is falsifiable, but consciousness, which is not falsifiable, is therefore different from it. That means consciousness and its content are separable, and that consciousness might be experienced without content. And we can compare this thesis with the absolute nature. That means in its absolute level, the absolute truth is that consciousness is without subject-object duality, it is without any content. Now, absurd as it may seem, Ratnakara Shanti's doctrine is in favor of the classical position, though he belonged to the later Yogacara period. That is, given the doctrine of the three natures, the idea that automatically is implied is consciousness is contentless. Bodhibhadra, a contemporary of Ratnakara and Gyanushri, writes as follows, and I am grateful also for this translation to my friend David Tomlinson, for this translation of Bodhibhadra's doctrine. The position that cognition, Bodhibhadra writes like this, that the position that cognition is contentless is taught by Arya Asanga and his followers. He obviously refers also to Basubandhu. They maintain that the content of cognition belongs to the imagined nature, parikalpita swabhava and is just as false as the as the hears seen by Yathaimerika. Concerning this, it is said in the Mahayana Sangraha, if the object of cognition is really proven to be an object, these would not be non-conceptual cognition or nirbikalpa kajjana. And without that, buddhahood cannot be attained. And again, he writes, when non-conceptual cognition is acquired, all objects no longer appear. Therefore, one must internalize the non-existence of the object. And since it is non-existence, the content of consciousness is also non-existent. It is clear that the position that consciousness is contentless is a statement about the ultimate nature of consciousness. Mental content is unreal and only obscures the true nature of consciousness as realized by the Buddha's nature, as realized by the Buddha. This hypothesis therefore proceeds from the assumption that Buddhahood is a real, contentless cognition. Of course, Gyanashri understands Buddhahood in a very different way. For him, it is the vivid, unfabricated knowledge of the truths the Buddha taught. That means Buddha, wherever there is consciousness, there would always be a content. This is the later Yogacara Sautrantika position which Gyanashri represented and was carried forth by Ratnakirti also. Now the content would be the four truths of the nobles in their various aspects, which knowledge is cultivated through innumerable lifetimes. Gyanashri's argument is that as long as one is conscious, some content must appear and one's consciousness must be of that content. Since a Buddha is conscious, he must be conscious of some content, though a unique content. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a lot of information and really fascinating lecture. So now we have time and open to discussions. Okay, any questions, sir? Yeah, okay.
Again, sir.
No, you have worked very hard. See, it's my problem. It's not. It's not a problem. You see, the one you have worked very hard. I appreciate this one, and but you have covered too much.
Yes.
And of course, you have started with three swabhava, which is only in Vasubandhu. And still, I think that three ni swabhava. The purpose is three ni swabhava. It's not swabhava. But here, what is the foundation of the reality, if there is any? Or of course there is. That is Paratantra. Paratantra is the foundation. So one goes above, imagination comes back. The task is coming back to Paratantra. So if there is some kind of parikalpit that is purely conceptual, something like that, and then at that level, grahya grahya bhav. If you correct it, come down to. But the nomenclature changes. From Paratantra to parikalpit, you analyze, it's a contentless. There is no ontology at that level. Coming down.
No, but you're saying according
coming
to
down to Paratantra.
Okay, Paratantra.
And so, the same Paratantra becomes Parinishvan.
Okay.
This is coming back to that original. And that's why Nisobhavata is still maintained. Because this is not substantial in the original sense. Otherwise, it will not be Buddhism.
Actually,
and the second thing.
Yeah.
Second thing. You have, maybe that you don't have enough time, that's why
no,
you could
sir,
not.
No, sir. Yeah,
the
please.
Second point is that whether it is Nyanusarani or Agamanusarani, it does not matter for me. Because what Vasubandhu, Asanga Vasubandhu, Maitre is perhaps imaginary, he is not the real, or perhaps Asanga is Asanga, as I accept. But I am not going into detail. Asanga and Vasubandhu, Asanga starts, Vasubandhu develops. And on Vasubandhu, later Vasubandhu, that there are two interpreters, Sthirmati and Dingna. Sthirmati goes in one direction, loss of mind you can send that, and here he gets in epistemology. But both are grounded in Vasubandhu and Asanga. Later they shift the focus to the philosophy of language. And that's why there is a continuity. But the ground is there. And everything is happening within the domain of mind, by mind, of mind. So content is always mental. And there is a purification, Shuddhikaran, and that is actually Parinisvan. And that becomes further a ground of Bodhisattva ethics, perhaps,
yes,
or something. Anyway, this is my comment, which is in your favor. No problem.
And thank you for a very lucid presentation. Just one minor point, that is, when you talk of three swabhavas, the word swabhava is not used in the sense of a characteristic. That is my just claim. I mean, you can react to that. That is, it is not swabhava of something.
No, it's it's
so,
essence.
Yeah, it is just, yeah, so three swabhavas means three kinds of phenomena, three kinds of things, not three characteristics of one and the same thing.
Yes.
So maybe there you have already.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. It's the, it's just the essence of that thing is that it is dependent, or it's not a characteristic, but just to express it in that way, we are saying that term. Yeah.
Let me. I have some queries and comments as a scientist. You know, the neuroscientists who are now trying to understand consciousness from point of view of functioning of the brain and neuronal activity, they are they are having a debate on content and context. They said that consciousness is nothing but kind of dialogue between thalamus and cortex. So if the content is put in the context, then and on, then we can think of kind of consciousness in neuroscience terminology. But contentless consciousness, they're still not understandable in present understanding of neuroscience. I mean, this is the status I am just telling.
Even the, I mean, the Nirakaravadins, they never see that that in the mundane level there is any consciousness which is devoid of content. It's only in the higher level or in the level of the Buddha that once they say that it's a sparkling consciousness without any specks or without any content, but not in the mundane level. Even they will not agree to that. And regarding that context, I'm not sure, but are they referring to, are they equating the context with the subject? If only there is a subject, then they can, the content can be internalized
put
or put in a particular. This is the, this is, I think, the what the Vijnanvadis will, I mean, this is their doctrine that there is nothing which is independent of consciousness. I think that is the basic tenet of idealism which they are supporting.
And one personal query.
Yes.
This is, there is another concept called Tathagata Garbha. So what is, I mean, when you say Alaya Vignano and Tathagata Garbha, how they are related or they are distinct concepts?
I'm not very sure, so this one I don't know, so sorry.
Okay, so any questions? Still we have little time. Yeah, okay.
Deep sleep. At that stage, there is consciousness, but this consciousness does not have any sort of content.
Contentless
like
consciousness
that.
At that stage.
So what will be their theory, especially that of the Sakaravadins?
No, actually, the Sakaravadins and the Nirakaravadins, their distinction is only at the absolute level. They never disagree that in the mundane level or in the reality, I mean, in this Sangriti Sat level, there is any any consciousness which is devoid of content. Regarding this Sushupti, I haven't read of
this. As far as my knowledge goes, they have discussed about dream states.
Dream states, but they, that is, dream states are with content.
Dream states are with content. Yes, because dreams are always having contents. But dreamlessly, have they discussed that?
Maybe. I'm not sure.
Because
I don't know. Maybe sir will be able to say that.
This is the question to...
Yeah, please.
You see, all these estates, see, except Turiya, in Vedanta, all these estates are natural. Whether you study Buddhism or not, is happening. In the same sleep, both can happen one after another. Suppose in the you are very tired, in the beginning you are dreamless. And then relax, and then after the dream starts. The situation is that in the waking state, all the faculties are active. In sleep, in dream state, only the mind is active, other organs are sleeping. Sensory organs, जो पांच ज्ञान इंद्रिय तो चलता रहता है ये तो माइंड जो है तो दोनों में चलेगा बट द थिंग
बट अबाउट
हाँ नहीं इसमें यह है कि सुषुप्ति डायरेक्ट तो समझने में थोड़ी दिक्कत होती है सुषुप्ति इज द स्टेट विच इज रिटर्नेबल ओके यू कैन रिटर्न नाउ सपोज आई से immediately it came to my mind that there is a possibility of coming back to the waking to that state of parikalpit etc parikalpit form but once you have cleansed the entire thing then you go beyond the susupti even so because susupti mein wo cheez hai jo hai wo sanskar bane rehte hain to hai aisa nahi ki nahi hai wo jo hai subdued hai लेकिन अगर उसको क्लींस कर देते तो वो जो है आप देन यू गो बियॉन्ड दैट परिनिष्पन्न में जा सकते हैं परिनिष्पन्न से दिस इज इट सो दिस जैसे गंगा है गंगा इतनी बहती है गंगे वो तो नहीं कचड़ा पड़ा था तो भी बह रही थी प्रतंत्र थी अब जो गंदगी हो गई परिकल्पित आ गया एक तरह से मॉडल ले लीजिए तो वो जो गंगा वही भी परिकल्पित प्रतंत्र तो है अब उसका शुद्धिकरण कर दिया अगर मान लीजिए मोदी जी ने तो उसकी शुद्धि हो गई लेकिन बहने की जो बात है परतंत्र नहीं जाता इसलिए माइंड को अगर क्लींस कर दिया माइंड ने खुद कर दिया जो मेथड है जो उसे कर दिया उसमें अब वो चीजें आ गई सुषुप्ति वाली बात को लगाने का ये है कि वो पॉसिबिलिटी अब नहीं है लेकिन सुषुप्ति में पॉसिबिलिटी है टू कम बैक हियर वो अब नहीं आएंगे वापस नहीं जाएंगे क्योंकि वो सारी चीजें प्री कंडीशन बुद्ध ने पूरा कर दिया ये जो जो भी बोधि प्राप्त करने का प्रयास करता है वो सारा प्री कंडीशन उसने अपना पूरा कर दिया वो अब अधिकारी हो गया और वो पूरा करने से ही तब बोधि होती है तो परिनिष्पन्न पर जाएंगे तो अब जो है सुषुप्ति जिस कंटेक्स्ट में कहा गया वो कंटेक्स्ट यहाँ नहीं लागू होगा लेकिन अच्छा क्वेश्चन है तो इन्होंने फंसा दिया आपको हमको
नो बट लेट मी ऐड वन मोर थिंग ओके
रिगार्डेड एज समथिंग सिमिलर टू दैट परिनिष्पन्न स्टेज बट ए टेम्पोरल वन So you are saying that in the case of Sushupti, there is in the stage of this Parinishpanna trance, there is a chance of there is no chance of any sort of defects of the mind. So when you look back into the world, then you will see the object as it is. So it is. The ultimate truth. But in the case of Sushupti, since the mind is already full with the defects and afflictions, etc.
Buddhism का एक रोल है कि आप जैसे मान लीजिए वेदांती लोग क्षमा करेंगे थोड़ा बहुत आदमी पढ़ता ही रहता है तुरीय स्टेट में चले गए सुषुप्ति के ऊपर तो मर गए नॉन रिटर्नेबल है
बट फॉर बुद्धिस्ट
हम वही कर रहे हैं लेकिन बुद्धिज्म को अभी एथिक्स करनी है मेटाफिजिक्स में एंड नहीं करना है क्योंकि उसमें इंडिविजुअलिटी खत्म हो जाती है इसमें इंडिविजुअलिटी जो ग्रोथ होती है उसकी वो बोधिसत्व बनने की क्षमता रहती है तो संसार में अभी बहुत कुछ काम करना है और काम करना है तो रिलेशन में काम करना है यानी जब हमारे सामने अभी इतना बड़ा प्रोजेक्ट है दुख निवृत्ति का चाहे जितना करना है तो वो मोटिवेट करता है, उस मोटिवेशन के लिए टू गो बियॉन्ड वन सेल्फ वन हैज टू ट्रांसफॉर्म वन सेल्फ। वो जो है परात्म समता की बात होती है या और कुछ बात होती है, तमाम तरह की एथिक्स शुरू हो जाएगी। इसको यहाँ रहना है अभी, ये प्रोजेक्ट मेरा पर्सनल हो सकता है, इसलिए बोधिसत्व तो क्वालिफाइड होगा भी तो भी नहीं जाना चाहता है। तो महाकरुणा का कंसेप्ट जब उत्पन्न हो जाएगा तो संसार में रहना ज्यादा पसंद होगा उसको, लेकिन उसके लिए ये सारी चीजें जो है ना, ये शुद्धिकरण जो प्योरिफिकेशन तो होगा।
ओके, मे बी वी कैन कंटिन्यू डिस्कशन ड्यूरिंग,
वो हम समझ रहे हैं।
या इट्स ऑलरेडी
ओके। धन्यवाद अध्यक्ष जी समय से समाप्त करने के लिए। और मैं आज के तीनों वक्ताओं को भी, इस सत्र के तीनों वक्ताओं, पेपर पढ़ने वाले तीनों वक्ताओं को भी, हमारे प्रोफेसर चिंचोरे जी और कुंतला भट्टाचार्य और हमारे क्या कहते हैं अधिकारी जी, आप तीनों को विद्वत्तापूर्ण अपने लेखों को यहाँ प्रस्तुत करने के लिए धन्यवाद देता हूँ।